Yeah, I think, you know, that's why we're in this space in the first place, right? Because we have a belief that we can change something. And, you know, it's just happening in a game right now. And that's incredibly powerful because it's like a Trojan horse for everything blockchain.
Hi guys, so we have great, you know, video recording time at this time, you know, interview with the Aleks from the Axie Infinity. And I'm really, really, really appreciate to your, you know, this arrangement for Mai. Yeah, thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you, Masa. And hi everyone, this is Miss Bitcoin Mai. And I'm very super honored and excited to be part of the Sky Marvis as an investor. And I want to do everything I can do expand the Axie community. And that's why I'm very happy to arrange this session. Masa is my very old friend in blockchain industry. And he is an entrepreneur and an investor. And he speaks good English. And yeah, and the most important point is he understands blockchain very well. So I think we can talk more deeply with Masa today. And recently, many people are talking and getting interested in Axie. But I want to say Axie was not built in a day. And since only a few people are interested in the blockchain game, and even in that was bear market, Axie have been continuously striving to expand the community, and I respect Axie community. So, and today I'm very excited to hear from Aleks about your journey. Thanks.
Yeah, totally true. You know, as a YouTuber, I'm also quite excited to help you guys to build a, you know, completely new pioneer world in a blockchain space applied to our world. So I really appreciate this opportunity too. So now it had to be your turn, Aleks.
Yeah, no. First of all, thank you for having me here. And thank you also, Mai, for introducing me to Masa. I'm very excited and also honored to present to the Japanese community. As Masa said, we have been, or as Mai said, we have been building for several years now. And actually, I was in Tokyo in 2018 when we just had got started. Presented Axie a little bit, and then, you know, it has been quite a long journey, but now we can see that we have a pretty exciting journey ahead of us, even where a lot of people are discovering Axie for the first time. But as Masa said, it has been a lot of work to get to this point, and it is not finished yet. We're building on new technology, right? So there are many challenges ahead, but hopefully, you know, in Axie, people can learn what is possible with this new technology, and together we can, you know, build a new gaming industry that's more fair, more open, and that people can, you know, actually own their game items. I think that's what's very exciting here.
Yeah, it's totally inspiring. You know, I love that kind of, you know, very ambitious project. Lovely. Great. So Aleks, probably you want to start from your, you know, kind of short pitch about your project, you know, Axie Infinity and, you know, Square Marvis.
Yeah, sure. So I think I'll just say it actually, because it's easier when you explain. I mean, Axie Infinity is at its core, a game where people have their main game characters. They're called Axies, and they can be used in many different games. You know, some of these games are the games that, you know, we, the Sky Mavis company, is building, like the battle game, which is more, you know, Pokemon-like. It's a little bit deeper. It's a strategic kind of chess kind of piece in there. That's a deeper level game, right? And then you have also the breeding game, which is another game that we create, which is also, you know, quite deep. And it's very, you know, the way that we create and get new axes into the world. People have to breed and they have to play. And then we're also working on, you know, a couple of new games. One is, you know, the kingdom-based game where you can own land and you can attack other players, very much like a massive multiplayer online type of environment. What we think is exciting is having NFT game characters that can be used in many, many different things. First, we have to create so that other people can see what's possible. And then in the future, anyone else can create as well. And that is actually the potential for NFT games, because it's more open and just more more possible for people to make things.
That's actually pretty, you know, inspirational. So which means that in long term, are you thinking about, you know, kind of open your platform to other like game creator or game player to develop their own world, like, you know, Oasis world? Like, oh, that's amazing and lovely. So great.
So, you know, the first step, you know, when you look at Axie as a game, right? What we need is many, many users. If you have users, it's easier to go from game to virtual world, right? That's just the way it is. But if you have a platform first, something like Somnium Space, Decentraland, or even the Sandbox, it's very hard because you need to first make the framework and the world, and then you need to make the content. You need to get players in. And it's much, from our opinion, we just have a different strategy. But the end goal, as you said, like an Axie virtual world where people can make their own games, and then eventually, you know, live inside that. And, you know, we already see that people are living, playing Axie. So it is the beginning of maybe Oasis. Yes, I'm not sure if it's going to be there in the very short term. But I mean, something like this is definitely possible in the future. And that's, you know, what I want to dedicate my life to and what I've been doing, why I'm working 12 hours every day. It's not actually about the money because, you know, we work in crypto. So there's a lot of hype, you know, suddenly everyone is rich. That's not really what it's about here. Like if we can impact the broader industry and actually push it forward, you know, there's so much responsibility here for when you think about how many people are, you know, like they are living in Axie, they are making, they are getting, eating food because of our game. It's mind blowing. Like it's totally insane.
Yeah, totally insane. So yeah, I want to enhance that. What you're talking about, the concept of living, let's say, you know, living with the NFT game. You know, one of the, you know, hot topic along with the game is like, you know, you try to realize the vision for the play to own world, especially leveraging the blockchain technology stuff, right? Also including the topics about your partnership with the YZZ, you know, next 2 to 3 years, especially what I want to, you know, try to realize that, you know, how you can connect that your, you know, gaming experiences inside of Axie Infinity to the real world. Like, you know, once we got to look at the Ready Player One world, but to me, it's kind of still separated, like a real world and a virtual world. And real life is kind of messy. But once you're going to get a pretty good well inside of a gaming space, you can be kind of getting rich outside the world. To me, it's kind of a very simple start. But in long term, when we think about the fully realized Oasis world by leveraging blockchain technology, you know, how kind of like a blueprint picture are you imagining right now? It's kind of a game right now. Yeah.
In Axie, we always think long term, right? So we start building very, you know, late 2017, early 2018, you know, it's a full bull market and then there's a bear market. And still, you know, even in the bear market, we keep building and building and building because we have this vision, you know, creating something good takes a long time. It's about craftsmanship. It's about, you know, giving everything you have into something and then, you know, you can reap the rewards in the future. So even though, you know, if people see now that there's a lot of hype in Axie, that's okay for us. It's not crazy. It's kind of the way that it should be in a natural progression of growth. And then, you know, in the future, maybe right now we maybe have 500,000. Like my goal is to get every person in the world to own Axie. And if we can get there, like how many, it's the total addressable market for something like Axie is massive, right? Every person can potentially own a game character like this because it's so that the broader appeal is there. And, you know, we are inspired by something like Pokemon. And I think, you know, for the millennial generation and everyone who is younger, Gen Z, like they want to, they connect more with what's happening in the digital space. So they want to own digital assets, not, you know, trading cards or, I mean, that's cool too, but it's hard to trade. It's hard to sell. It's, you can't even look at it on the screen when you spend most of your time in the game. So, and in online. So I think that's very natural that you know, that's the next progression where people will live inside games, but it can take, you know, 10 years, 20 years. And that's, you know, the time horizon that we are aiming for because people have a tendency, you don't think that it's going to happen in the short term, but like you think it's going to happen in the short term, but it doesn't happen in the short term. Everything like happens in the long term and suddenly you kind of get there. It's just a matter of time and effort and how long you can stay focused and grinding. The most important thing is that the team that's behind the product doesn't burn out. If you can have the same passion that you had when you were building in a bear market, and this goes for any kind of product, any kind of game, then you can create something amazing for the entire world. So yeah, we try to stay cool And even though, you know, there's a lot of responsibility, but yeah, it's just a long-term thing for us and it can take many, many years.
I say totally true. So I think we got to cover like two kind of key topics here, you know, what I'm talking about right now. So first thing about how you're going to build the ownership for the player side. I totally, you know, agree with your idea. It's because, you know, this is, you know, directly connected to our concept of DAO mechanism on the blockchain. Any kind of DAO application has to seriously think about, you know, how they're going to develop the effective DAO ecosystem. And the second thing is about, you know, what you're talking about, well, like, you know, how you're going to build the sustainable game on our NFT space, right? Then let's start from the first one. So, you know, currently, you know, how are you guys working so seriously to work the effective, like, you know, building ownership for the player side? Like community mm-hmm. perspective or DAO perspective, anything is fine. Please, you know, share your idea right now or topics any kind of working right now.
We always had the idea that, you know, if we were going to issue a token, right, a token for the company or for the game, it mm-hmm. needed to be like on the cutting edge of token design. Mm-hmm. And there were so many tokens in the bear market to me that didn't really make sense because mm-hmm. they had no use case. There is no mm-hmm. reason to hold on to the token.
True.
You don't really have any reason for it. You're just speculating. You're just a gambling person. Mm-hmm. Right? That's it. So, you know, for us, it was very short term stuff, right? Yeah. So for us, it was very different. Like when we go back and design the token, we need to look at the end goal. So if the end goal for Axie is to turn it into a DAO, which is owned by the players and the holders of this token, then we need to start looking at the design space from there. So how can we, you know, incentivize the right kind of behavior inside the game by using the token? And those who do the right things in the game, they should be rewarded. They deserve new tokens and like even revenue if we decide to split that out to the players. So, you know, Sky Mavis, we hold a lot of tokens on our balance sheet. Rather than, you know, taking a cut of each thing like that, that cut that's on the marketplace, that's our revenue that actually goes into a treasury, which is then, you know, shared with all the holders of the AXS token. So that's, you know, the first step of a DAO. And then eventually, I think we will see how much we can open up for the players to decide. Because when you are, you know, because you're building on something that is so fragile, that is so new, that nobody has done in the same way before. If you let the players decide everything, it probably will get destroyed. So maybe, so maybe at first you just need to let the players decide a little bit. And that's, you know, the first step into a DAO.
I see.
Everything is, you know, about the long-term thinking of the company. And when you have people in the community, they might own a lot of token and they say, oh, we want to give rewards now to everyone, like that's a pretty bad, you know, long-term strategy.
Pretty risky for you too. It's pretty risky for you too.
Yeah, so we need to. Yeah. So it's like a very, you know, we have economics, economists who are working on this to make sure that we don't, you know, mess it up. I have a background in economy, and the same for Jeff, who is also one of our co-founder, Jiho. So you know him, I guess, Mai. So he's very very interested. I think, you know, the economy of Axie is very, very important. Because if we can make the economy work, the economy is very, like, if we can't make the economy work, like, probably nothing else will work either, because it's such an important piece of it.
Well, that's why, you know, how we're going to design a token economy is all the time major topic for the every single blockchain project stuff. So now, I also kind of like, you know, I guys also seriously working on a community treasury program on your DAO program. That's also quite interesting about it. And then I gradually see that why you guys like, you know, kind of, you know, switching point between, you know, staking revenue, standing for a pretty high stats, but gradually you guys want to develop the community like incentive or program stuff. Then you're going to, you know, eventually switch their revenue balance, right? So in long term, community reward program is much more beneficial or profitable for the DAO mechanism or any kind of participant stats compared with this proof of staking model. I see. That's a good idea too.
So it's a very, you know, good observation and something that I care a lot about, you know, because when you are trying to bootstrap a network, like you want people to hold on to the token, you need to have a high, you know, issuance or distribution of new tokens, because maybe the treasury is quite small. So the treasury needs time to build. And then, you know, as the treasury is building, you reduce, you know, the issuance of new tokens like increase and then they meet in the middle. And that's, you know, the very, you know, key moment. And it's quite beautiful in the, like, considering the math.
Very true.
Yes, because if you can do that, then you can have a long-term, you know, sustainable thing inside the game. And it's not everything about, you know, continuous growth. There has to be, of course, ways that we, you know, make money for the treasury, but you know, the design space there is almost completely open. So like right now we only make money from marketplace fees and breeding, but imagine if we can, you know, issue some cosmetic or, you know, some battle pass or, you know, all of these other things that, you know, normal games are doing so that people can have a better experience. And, you know, that's the potential for something like Axie. You know, it's still so early. And the reason why it's so early, because we have to build the infrastructure too. I mean,
true.
Yeah. And that's, I guess, it's a good point from your last video when you were, you know, looking at, you know, what makes Axie unique. It's not only about dApps, but it's also about infrastructure and combining like those two things together, because that's really the only way that we can, you know, distribute the game to the global market. Because if we don't have a stable infrastructure, then we can't, you know, reach hundreds of millions of players. That's where we want to go. And that's, you know, right now we are testing a lot. The servers are, you know, being pressured. Like now it's growing something like 10, 20,000 players every day, which is, you know, it's very high. So our engineers, they are not sleeping. It's like, it's a luxury problem.
Yeah.
Yes, everything is on fire. But you know, that's when things are on fire, that's also when you learn and you grow and you become stronger, right? So you get tested, and then and then you can kind of break through that, and then you can, you know, ship a better game for everyone in the world. So right now, everyone who is playing Axie, you're still testing just the future of how big this can be. So we keep saying that, but it's, you know, a little bit hard for people to understand, I think.
I see. Very true. So gradually, I can imagine that probably one of the way to build the effective DAO ecosystem for you guys in the beginning, probably you got to allow the, you know, player to design any kind of new character on Axie. Then probably in long term, maybe you're going to allow to the some player to add some kind of battle rules or like a bleeding model or something, or open a completely new, you know, playing field or something. That kind of step.
Yeah.
Are you guys thinking right now?
It's very, very long term. I think, first step, you know, make us something sustainable. First step, make sure that everyone can use this across the world. And then the next step is, you know, EVE Online is the very, you know, natural example, because they have lived for, I don't know, 20 years or something, or maybe even longer, right? So the these blockchain game economies, these communities, these networks, that's actually what it is. They can live even longer than longer than us. Like digital assets will be here for many years. Like we won't, like maybe in 50 years, we are all dead, but Axie will still be here.
Right, that's what we're gonna imagine right now. I see. So you know, thinking about, you know, let's move to the next second topic about sustainability of the NFT game. So, you know, once we're gonna look at the entire gaming world, so you know, as you know, we have a couple of the long, you know, long run game, starting from Minecraft, that's, you know, one of the good examples too. Then, you know, how are you gonna thinking about sustainability of the NFT game? Because, you know, one of it's also, to me, it's also, you know, connected to your, you know, product vision as a running project. Because, you know, it's also actually related to your competition with Flow too. Because, you know, think about, you know, what's this world in long-term NFT game. You know, we have kind of a couple of directions about your product development style. The first one is, you know, you have a multiple game title on top of the running platform, or you have kind of, you know, key, you know, growth driver, like a killer application, game application, like Axie Infinity. Then inside of this, you know, Axie Infinity, like universe or something, small game, come to this market, like, you know, Facebook, you know, gaming zone in the past, then, you know, some of the game expanding their gaming zone outside of like an Axie Infinity on top of the running platform or something. So how are you going to think about to develop those kind of like, you know, sustainable gaming zone on NFT set, especially in a running project?
Yeah, that, I mean, you're describing it perfectly. That's our plan. So yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, no, that's exactly what we're doing. It's like the only thing, you know, that, because users are the power here. If you have players, you can bring them to other games, right? If you want to, or you can, you know, at least maybe not bring them, but you can give them, you know, that you can say, here's another good game that we are deciding that we are partnering with. Some, you know, very high level game studio or some other great game that we think, you know, has the potential to be like Axie. Maybe we can let other players use it, right? So this is also a long-term strategy, but, you know, that's for Sky Mavis as a company, right? So for Sky Mavis, you know, we make different products Axie mm-hmm. is one of the products, and mm-hmm. that will be decentralized through the token, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And then we will mm-hmm. have some other games maybe or something else that also could be decentralized, right? The Rollin blockchain, right? Mm-hmm. That will mm-hmm. also be decentralized because it needs its own token so that mm-hmm. it can, you know, secure the consensus, so that it is secure for the mm-hmm. future. And, you know, mm-hmm. when I think about Axie or in Sky Mavis versus Flow and, mm-hmm. you know, NBA Top Shot, I think it's a very different thing because mm-hmm. actually NBA Top Shot is, you know, a collectible only, like it's tied to another mm. intellectual property mm. like the NBA.
True.
In Axie, we make something totally new. Like there is no Axie IP before us. Mm. So we mm. are only focused on one intellectual property, and that's, you know, mm. what we want to make into something amazing, and we own mm. that. It's not mm-hmm. the NBA. We don't have to partner with some of those guys unless we want to, and mm-hmm. then they can maybe do something cool inside the Axie universe. But mm-hmm. yeah, it's I think it's a different level of you know, game mm. design, and maybe also the way that we think about the long term of mm-hmm. NFT mm-hmm. project and making mm-hmm. it sustainable. We just do one thing, like Axie, mm-hmm. that's it. Like that's the main mm-hmm. thing we do. mm-hmm. And then eventually we can open this up for other people in the future too.
I see, so which means that if you think about the sustainability of Axie Infinity, once you can make the pretty scalable and a sustainable kind of character design program or something, you know, with your DAO mm-hmm. member, that'd be, you know, much more competitive one, especially compared with Flow, because, you know, as you said, they rely on the other IP product, but you're trying to build the completely original character design and also the IP, you know, business stuff from the leveraging, you know, DAO community. It's a completely new approach, right?
Yeah, it's more, we think it's more fair, and we think it's that's better right. for more everyone, fair, right? And right. you know, it and you know, the funny story, you know, Sky Mavis, we don't have the same level of money that Dapper mm. Labs have. Like they always had more money than us, but it doesn't mm. really matter. Like we just mm-hmm. believe in the community, and we mm. just, you know, keep building. And now, you know, that it's a success, everyone wants to, you know, be with us, and that's okay. But, you know, from, yeah, take a step back and think like long-term about this thing that you're making it fly here.
That's okay. But yeah, it's kind of a long-term project, but, you know, once you're going to make that happen, it's kind of huge innovations about, you know,
I think so.
In the world. Yeah. Right.
The thing is, you know, these normal game studios, they don't understand how this is possible. So,
right.
Yeah, the interesting thing here is, you know, when you look at a traditional game industry, how they make money, they sell from game studio to player. Mm-hmm. That's the only thing they do. They make money if you buy from player, and then you are stuck as a player. You can't do anything with it. In Axie, we don't sell directly to the players unless the players are, you know, actively contributing. Like in the breeding transaction, there are two things. We make money by, you know, by players like buying AXS token and, you know, spending that, but they also need smooth love potion. And we don't sell the smooth love potion. The only way to get it is to play the game and find it. Mm-hmm. That is totally unique from any other game, you know, that you find on the market today. It's not the same, you know, level. And what makes it unique is also that it can be traded. You know, that people can actually speculate on this asset. You know, there are futures market right now. Like there's so many different things that are happening. And I think, you know, when normal studios, they don't understand because they are so used to thinking in the way of extracting value from the player.
I see.
They only want to make money. They don't want to give anything back. So from our opinion, it's much more powerful if you can give something back, because the new mindset is, the old mindset is, you know, me versus player, or big company versus person. Web3 mindset is developers with the users. The same, like we're together in this, trying to push the world forward. I think that's the unique thing about Axie and also and many, many other, you know, Web3 products.
I see. Totally true. Totally agree with that. So that's also developed a very, you know, effective, you know, but now community culture inside Axie Infinity too. But also the kind of a discussion also, you know, tell me that, you know, the things I want to know is like, how you're going to design a token economy stuff with a variety of the products, because currently you have, you know, AXS tokens, and inside of Axie Infinity, you also, you know, SLP tokens that now you have running. Kind of, you know, question from a little investor perspective, but, you know, are you guys also planning to issue the, you know, token for a running platform? Or how are you going to design entire token economies with this variety of problems?
It all depends. Like, I don't believe in tokens without purpose. Every token that you create needs to have a specific purpose.
Right.
So for the Ronin network, it needs a token so that it can provide security for the Ronin network. We create the product. We need tokens so that people can stake and run validators. You know, Ronin will be a proof of stake system in the end, where people are staking their tokens and can stake on validators. So that is coming, but it's not something like we don't actually want to sell the tokens. We would rather that people, you know, they contribute to the network by, let's say they can farm it in something else and then they can sell it to other players, right? That's important to us. So if we were to sell this token, we could probably make like, I don't know, a lot of money, but it's not about that. Like, it's about getting the tokens into the hands of the users, actually, so that you have a, you know, it's called a Gini coefficient. So the higher, you know, distribution of the tokens to a broader user base, the better it is for everyone, right? Because, you know, it's less concentrated in the hands of whales. So we don't want to sell to, you know, just one person or one investor or one VC, but rather, you know, have it open so that anyone can buy and then and then farm inside the game. So I think it's very excited, but we will be releasing more information about the Ronin token soon.
I see, that's interesting. So about you guys thinking about, like, you know, kind of a token to token connectivity inside of, you know, playing or behaving inside your ecosystem. So
it could be,
you know, yeah, that kind of, you know, approach also could be possible too. Interesting. I see, yeah, of course, you know. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
So, you know, one of the things that we don't have on Ronin right now, you know, is a decentralized exchange for fungible tokens, right? You cannot trade the AXS to Ether, or you cannot trade, you know, USDT to Ether, but we will have that soon. So we will have our own DEX so that people don't have to, you know, go to Ethereum if they want to. And maybe at that point, you can have like an ecosystem where if you provide liquidity in AXS and Ether, maybe you can farm some Ronin tokens, right? These are things that we are thinking about, right? Because then you are adding, like, because the liquidity is important for players to be able to buy and sell. And, you know, it drives more volume to our marketplace. So these are the kind of design things that we are thinking about.
Right,
care about Axie stuff, right? Everything we do needs to push Axie forward in some way.
That's interesting. But that also complicated design work. But once you're gonna make that so in a scalable way, that's impressive. I love that. I do find you love that way too.
Yeah, the reason, you know, why we can think about this, like, you know, because we have experience in the space for 3 years. Like it's not something you can just make in one day. You really need to think a long term, like, about this, and, you know, have very, like, extensive models, and then you can figure it out. But even if you have very, you know, good models, things still don't work out the way you planned. So planning only can take you so far. A lot of the thing is, you know, being there, operating, doing it live, you know, seeing players, they are struggling, they have problems, we need to help them. They don't understand, right? So that's important for us, like, to educate the users about what's happening.
True. And then also you can learn from them too. Then how you're going to, you know, run.
It's about design, right?
User. Right. Now we are discussing about the Ronin stuff. So I'm also a little bit, you know, you're going to apply the proof of stake model for the Ronin. And I totally agree with that idea too, because, you know, every single BaaS project these days, they're going to apply the proof of stake model. That's also a secure way to build the ecosystem stuff. But my next question is, you know, what kind of, you know, technology you're going to apply for the scalability of the, you know, Ronin side of chain technology?
Yeah. So, you know, when we were, we have to start from the start, actually, because, you know, all our design, like, all, it's a very logical approach, actually. So, you know, we started building on Ethereum. Everything was, you know, we had everything on chain. The entire battle system was on chain. It was terrible. You had to send one transaction. Your opponent does the same. Boom, they battle. It's disaster, right? So we kind of take a step back in terms of centralization. So we took a lot of the stuff inside the game. And then we started thinking, well, Ethereum is so popular. Everyone wants to use Ethereum block space in the future because it's such a, like, innovation. It's so unique. So we started looking at other scalable solutions, and we looked at, familiar with the Loom network? Have you heard about Loom? Yeah. So we started, you know, using Loom network first, and then it was bad. Like, they pivoted into healthcare. So they changed their strategy, and that, you know, messed things up for us very heavily. So we needed to take a step back, and then this was maybe mid 2019. So we were looking at all of the other options that were on the table. And what we figured out is that there is nothing good for NFTs at the time. So we had the experience, we had the engineers to build our own sidechain. So we kind of, we used the Ethereum virtual machine, we forked it off, we created our own code base, and we built first a POA system. So that, you know, there is no staking or anything like that. You have validators, it's quite centralized. And the next step in the evolution of Ronin is to turn it into POS. So that, you know, it's a proof of stake system where people are staking their tokens and they have some validators that we know. The end goal for something like Axie and Ronin could be something totally different. Like we are looking at, you know, ZK syncs, Optimism, even Arbitrum, and, you know, all of these other, even Starkware. Right, all of these other like
layer solutions.
Because you know what we want to do in the end is, you know, like we don't want to be centralized in this point, but right now it's just something we have to do because there is no other way to scale this to the amount of users that we have. So our approach is very, you know, business minded, consumer centric. We can afford to take a step back on decentralization for now, as long as we have a clear plan to do it in the future. And I think that's, you know, the reason that we can do that is because we have legitimacy, because we've been doing this for some time and people trust us. I know it's a little bit weird from, you know, a blockchain perspective, because everything should be trustless. It's so early that if we are making everything trustless, we would never get to this point where we are today.
Sure.
It's just impossible to design in the space that we have. So we have to, you know, make these sacrifices in terms of decentralization, right? You know, it's the eternal like speed and like trust. Like how can you can't have everything in life. So we have to make some decisions on behalf of our players and they have to trust us for it. But in the future, hopefully things will be different. But you know, it's very hard to predict just how strong, you know, these, there's so many smart people building in the space. I mean, nobody had, you know, predicted Satoshi would make Bitcoin, right? And the Nakamoto consensus, like nobody understood that before. So we can have very like heavy innovations on the, you know, academic front, but that's not, you know, what we want to do. That's something for someone else to research. They can do that, but, and we can make the consumer facing product. Everything, like we take what they have and we apply it in our business use case. And that's how you can make something that people want to do, like people want to want to experience.
I see. That's, you know, so from the infrastructure development perspective, compared with especially Flow, you know, your guys' policy is more like a step-by-step model and a, you know, more risk control model, because in Flow, building a pure, you know, complete new BaaS project, then try to directly compete with Ethereum. But in your case, you're going to apply the sidechain technology. So all the time you're open to accept or apply any kind of layer two technology, you know, around, you know, Ethereum ecosystem. And then, well, as we know that, you know, since, you know, Ethereum ecosystem open source, it's pretty, you know, strong. So that is why it's easier for you guys to apply, you know, those new technology for your sidechain platform. And then about final validation model, still you can run on an Ethereum platform. That is why from the technical perspective, that's more, you know, kind of a purely, you know, constructive way you can develop your infrastructure step by step. Now, I say that probably makes sense for me.
Yeah, we think it's very logical. And you know, we didn't ever want to compete with Ethereum. You know, we think Ethereum is probably the future of Web3. Like we think we might be Ethereum maximalist to an extent, but because we think, you know, the network effects in Ethereum are so strong already, and it's related to the Ethereum virtual machine, the code base, you know, that has, you know, found product market fit. So I'm not sure if it's going to be like that forever, but we have a very, you know, open ended there. Like it's too early, I think, to say to say exactly how the future will turn out. So so yeah, we prefer to keep it standard. I think for Flow, I think they even made their own coding language, so it's like they have, I mean, yeah, if they want to do that, that's okay. It's just that not something we want to do. Like we would rather, like our entire community was on Ethereum, and you know, having that bridge from Ronin to Ethereum is so important, right? It's not right now. We don't have a bridge for the NFT because they live on Ronin, but we have a bridge to fungible tokens like AXS and Ether. But in the future, you can be able to bridge your Axie from Ronin back to Ethereum. And you know, that's the, it's a little bit when you think, you know, from a tree, if you consider, you know, Ethereum, the main, you know, trunk, then you have like Ronan on the side here a little bit, and then they can, you know, move back in there. I think that's, you know, the best approach for now, because then we can even use the technical innovation that happens on Ethereum, and we can take what they find, fork off, and use it on Ronin. And the good thing about building on an EVM is that any kind of innovation that happens on Ronin, well, that can be used on Ethereum too. So it's actually complementary for Ethereum to have someone like us building there.
Kind of quiet and constructive stressful model. Yeah, I love that idea too. Great. Kind of close to the final question. So actually, I want to also discuss with you about, you know, DeFi with the NFT, especially the, you know, especially the world of play to earn. Because then one of the reasons I, you know, got the, you know, one of strong instance in Axie Infinity, because, you know, it's completely new kind of a user ecosystem open happening here inside Axie Infinity. And one of the reasons actually YZZ, you know, especially thinking about the play to earn world from the, you know, emerging economy, you know, YZZ to me, it looks like it played a critical role on inside Axie Infinity community stuff. Then why I think so, because to me, the YZZ looks like, you know, young finance for NFT. So
something like that.
Yeah, something like that. How are you guys like, you know, thinking about those kind of, you know, DeFi ecosystem development stuff, you know, working with YZZ? You are open to, you know, any kind of player, or you all the time continue discussing with them? Just I'm curious about that point.
Yeah, so I mean, full disclosure, I am one of the advisors in YGG. I am also one investor in YGG. So I try to, you know, take a little bit of a, I love Gabby. I think it's great. I think, I think, you know, what YGG is doing is amazing. They are, you know, basically a job board for the metaverse. So, you know, they hire many players and they let them work inside many different games. So they don't even, you know, need to own expensive assets. So I think that's amazing because they open up more opportunities for people.
Right.
From so I can say that, like, my personal opinion. But, you know, from a Sky Mavis perspective, everything that we do, like, in the future will be more open. Like, we don't want to only focus on one party. Like, I think if YGG is the first, that's great, because then they can show other people what's possible here. And there are other competitors too. But I think YGG is probably the ones who are closest to, you know, building something that's, you know, a more sustainable model for its employees, I should say. Like, it's a guild that's hiring other players. So it's groundbreaking. I think, you know, everything that's happening in the Axie community will be some kind of movie in the end, because it's so special. So. Yeah. Yes. I think so. And it's so new that it hasn't, you know, you know, they are even raising a lot of money. They are hiring people. They are, it's a true business, right? So when you compare that, you know, DeFi and NFT, you know, Axie Infinity would not be in the situation where we are today without Uniswap. For example, the first pair, SLP and Ether was created by the community on Uniswap. That's it. Like, when that happened, it was a like innovation trigger, because that means that people can play the game and make money at the same time.
Yeah.
So it's so unique. So like, what I like to say is, you know, DeFi and NFTs, it's nice, but, you know, I'm not here to be a finance professional. Like, I don't care about finance so much. Like, I think it's okay, but the market for financial professionals is so small. Like, real people don't care about finance stuff.
True.
Real people care about games, and they want to use, you know, cool pictures and cool things in life. The finance market is big, but I mean, I think consumer facing products have more power in the world. I think so. Yeah,
totally true. That's also kind of, you know, breakthrough disruption, kind of, we're working on it with the, you know, blockchain technologies too. So think about the, like, you know, combination with YZZ, one of the possibilities, but I'm thinking about, like, you know, it's all the time looking for, you know, someone will build the decentralized crowdsourcing platform, you know, how, you know, incentivize user or make money through the, you know, blockchain space. And finally, I came up with, you know, Axie Infinity and YZZ, or that could be possible. That's what I, you know, figured out, you know, huge possibility out there too. Then in long term, like, you know, since to me, the NFT with the next key driver for the DeFi space, but the reason is actually exactly as you said, you know, from the retail investor perspective, current DeFi still to me, it's a little complicated, because, you know, you have to have like a major crypto assets and you're going to put in some, you know, assets at both. That's easy, but, you know, it's not directly connected to their real life. But once we look at the Axie Infinity, why are you going to play some kind of very, you know, common use game, major game stuff, but actually you can make money. Once you're going to build the asset inside a game, you can leverage that asset in the DeFi space, and the more you can earn more money, and then you can live your life, as you said, you know, in the beginning. So that kind of like, you know, completely new lifestyle is coming to right now for us. That's what I think about.
You don't, yeah, because you don't need a bank account.
Right.
So yeah, you can just, you know, this, we are banking the unbanked. That's right. It. Like, you don't, right. Because, right. You know, your Axie account is your first bank account.
Right.
That's insane, right? That's it. Because you can start in Axie, you own money, you own Axies, yeah. You can just play. And then suddenly you have something that nobody, no bank in the world, they don't have any idea.
You don't need,
and they
don't
shouldn't either
anymore.
Because it's your money.
Anymore,
like,
right? Just email and a password. That's it.
Yeah, that's it. Like, no, I get so angry when I see, you know, the traditional industry. Yeah, I think, you know, that's why we're in this space in the first place, right? Because we have a belief that we can change something. And, you know, it's just happening in a game right now. And that's incredibly powerful because it's like a Trojan horse for everything blockchain. And, you know, that's
usually,
what we believed in, right?
Yeah, legacy industry player or government people never care about, you know, game market development stuff, ever. You know, to me, they're kind of virtual world. But actually, innovation happening here is completely disruptive one. Yeah, that's the things we are, you know, kind of looking right now. That's amazing.
What we are going to be doing now is, you know, focusing more on regional markets and, you know, influencers. You know, what we've seen is like in the Filipino area, right? We have many, many, you know, influencers, and that's, you know, where it grows fastest. But in the future, we will be doing, you know, more localization, like having a Japanese like version of the game once it gets fully released.
Wonderful.
Like have a
great.
Japanese community manager, that kind of stuff, because we know the Japanese, you know, community, they're very, they want things to work. Course I also want things to work, so we don't want to we can't release the market, the product, into the wild before it is high enough quality that we can be proud of it. So so that's why, you know, the easiest thing for players, if they want to, you know, if they want to, you know, have exposure to Axie, is just buy AXS token. If you are comfortable with, you know, playing a game that's in alpha stage, that is very popular, that, you know, has, that sometimes goes down a little bit. I mean, yes, you can start playing Axie, but I'm just telling you straight up that there's so many players that want to play Axie Infinity right now that it will be unstable for some time until we can, you know, fix everything. And it's going to take a little bit of time because I don't think any crypto product has seen so much growth as we have
ever.
So it's maybe NBA Top Shot, but they also, you know, right now they have nothing. So right now I think is everything Axie, but you know, these things are cyclical, right? They go up and down. It's about the long term, right?
That's all that's happening about the, you know, pioneer industry, pioneer market. Totally true. Especially about the Japanese market developing stuff, the Mai will definitely help you out. Yeah, because she is the most talented person, you know, about the Japanese market developing stuff. I know that too.
Yeah, when is there, like, if there is, you know, Japanese crypto...
non-fungible Tokyo? No?
Yeah, there are more conferences and stuff. Maybe we can travel there and meet you face-to-face. Would be fun. I mean, I saw Mai last year, or maybe 2 years ago now, for Tokyo, like NFT non-fungible Tokyo meetup. So that was fun. But yeah, it's a little bit now, maybe the market is bigger.
Sure, sure. Yeah, because, you know, Japan is one of the major kind of gaming, you know, live country in the world.
Yeah. So what we find, you know, is Axie is actually somewhat a good fit for Japanese sometimes because it's a very grindy, very grindy game. So you can actually, you can play a long time, and even, you know, compete. We have a Japanese community now on our Discord server. You know, unfortunately, our Japanese Twitter page got shut down. So maybe we have to make a new one, as we start building more on the Japanese community again.
Sounds great. So recently, I found many blogs. So many bloggers write about Axie, and I think it's a great time to create a new Twitter account in Japanese.
We'll do that probably right now.
Right.
I think it's okay.
Yeah, so probably, you know, wrap up timing for us for this interview. Mm-hmm. So Alex, so do you have any kind of final words for us? So think about your vision about play to earn, or like any kind of things you were thinking about, you know, future development stuff.
I think Axie Infinity and blockchain games are going to change the way that games are being played forever. It's just a matter of time until the larger game studios also understand this, until, you know, every game asset will be an NFT. And the reason for that is because players will demand it. They will demand that they can own their assets and that they can have a say in the products that they use. It's also related to digital identity. Like right now, people are giving away all of their information on Facebook and Twitter and all of these things. We should own our own assets in everything in life, not only like money, but also information, game assets. Like that is human right to own the things that you have. So I think that we are getting there. But if you want to support Axie, you should definitely get involved. It's incredibly exciting. Still early days. We need all the support that we can get from the crypto community.
Great. Thank you for what you find out. And in the end, I truly hope that we can make the Ready Player One 2 together.
Yes.
Great. So thank you very much for your taking time this time. I truly appreciate, and also I truly admire your hard work, last 3 years, and you finally came up with this amazing traction stuff. But still, you already accept that this is just the beginning for you, right? So let's continue to work together, develop, this great ecosystem, developing together, happen. Also, all the time, I and mine open to anything to help you out to, make your project successful continuously. Yeah.
Okay. Right? Well, it was nice chatting with you guys. Okay, have a nice day. Bye.
Thank you.
Arigato.
Okay, thank you. Bye.
Watching.